Hello again, students. I hope you've been finding this class informative so far. In this section, we're going to study another quasi-experimental method called propensity score matching. As before, we'll first talk generally about the method, then get down to the mechanics of how it works. Then we'll discuss limitations and reality checks, and end with a discussion of a couple of research papers that use matching. Before starting in, let's remember that the ideal way to measure the effect of a treatment or policy is random assignment. If treatment is not randomly assigned, then we have to worry about selection bias. In other words, without random assignment, the outcome for the untreated is not a valid counterfactual for what would have happened to the treated group in the absence of treatment. In theory, what matching does is to address this problem as follows. For every unit receiving treatment, we find another unit not being treated that is otherwise identical to the treated unit. In this way, the treated and untreated groups should more or less be identical, and we can use the difference in outcomes between the treated and untreated as a valid measure of the effect of treatment, just as we would if the treatment had been randomly assigned. Let me give a concrete example. Suppose we're interested in the effects of a country adopting a fixed exchange rate on its inflation rate. But we know the treatment here, having a fixed exchange rate, is not randomly assigned, and we are worried about selection bias. In matching, for every country with a fixed exchange rate, we find a country whose exchange rate is not fixed that is otherwise as close as possible to the fixed rate country in all other relevant categories, like GDP, form of government, demographics, openness to trade, tax system, and so on. Since we might have a very large number of categories, which makes matching complicated, we often estimate a first stage equation that gives us the probability a country adopts a fixed exchange rate. We call that estimated probability the country's propensity score. Suppose one of the fixed rate countries had a propensity score of 0.6. We would then look to match it to a non-fixed rate country that also had a 0.6 propensity score. Once each of the treated countries are matched to a non-treated country with a similar propensity score, we then compare the average inflation rate in the treated countries to the average inflated rate in the matched non-treated countries, and that would be our measure of the effect of the treatment on inflation. That's propensity score matching in a nutshell. To make matching work, we need a strong first-stage model that gives good predictions of the probability of adopting treatment. We'll address this later in the section. We also need a method to determine the specific unit or units to match with each treated unit. Once the first-stage probability of policy adoption equation is estimated, to ensure that we get good matches, we restrict our analysis to the region of common support. By that I mean, if we graph the distributions of propensity scores for the treated and untreated units, we only use matching in the area where the two distributions overlap. In this region of overlap, we can use nearest neighbor matching, which takes as the control the non-treated unit with the closest estimated probability of adopting the policy. Or we could use kernel matching, which matches each treated unit with a weighted average of all the non-treated units in the region of common support. The further the non-treated unit's propensity score is from the treated unit being matched, the lower is the weight for that unit. We can also use matching with or without replacement. Nearest neighbor matching with replacement means that a non-treated unit could be used as the matched control for multiple treated units. Even if we do everything right, though, we may still be worried that there are unobservable factors which influence both the decision to adopt the treatment and the outcome variable. Since we can only match on observables, matching is open to be criticized because it doesn't account for possible unobservables. However, we'll see that combining matching with difference in differences is a hybrid approach that helps to deal with time-invariant unobservables. That is, we could take our treated units and matched controls, and instead of just taking the difference between them as the treatment effect, we could calculate the difference between them before treatment, the difference after treatment, and take the difference between those differences as our estimated treatment effect. Another way to say this is we could use matching to create the control group for a diff-and-diff analysis like we discussed in the previous module of the course.